I have a secret recipe for a healing salve that we use in our family to work miracles. Hi, I'm Kylene, and I'm the Provident Prepper. This healing salve has worked miracles in our family. My daughter called me the other day and begged me to make her a new batch because she has a little reoccurring rash on her face, and this is the only thing that will take care of it. So in this video, I'm going to share with you exactly how I make it, which herbs I choose, and why I choose to grow those medicinal herbs in my garden, and the benefits that it has not only in the garden before I harvest it, but once it's in this salve. Stay tuned. Today, I am going to share my recipe for a homemade healing salve that is absolutely incredible. Before we get started, it's important to note that I'm a mom and not a doctor. I use this salve for my own family, and I use medicinal herbs that I have grown in my own yard to make it. This is not medical advice, and there are 100 different ways to make salves and all kinds of ingredients and oils and all different things that you can use in them. This is just the one that I make and I use, and every time I make it, it'll be just a little bit different. I originally got started because I had a family member who got hurt, and comfrey ointment was recommended as part of the healing process. I went and bought this little 2-ounce container and paid over $10 for that jar. And I read the ingredients showing that it was made of organic comfrey leaf, I grow that in my yard, and beeswax and extra virgin olive oil. I could totally do that. So that's when I started to explore the wonderful world of salves. Now that being said, I appreciate a lot of Dr. Christopher's different products and the products that are out there, so you don't have to make this on your own. For me, the mother of a whole pile of children, it's a little bit cost prohibitive, and whenever I can do things on my own, it just saves me a lot of money. This is my general recipe, and we'll go through each of these ingredients and explain exactly why I like to use which ingredients in my salves. My favorite oils to use for salve is a combination of coconut oil and avocado oil. You can use a huge variety of different oils depending on what you're specifically creating your salve for and what you prefer. I personally don't like to use olive oil in my salves because I think it smells like a salad. I'd prefer the coconut oil and the avocado oil, but it's completely up to your personal preference. The salve needs to be thickened, and we use beeswax for that. You can buy bulk beeswax or use your own, but I really like these little pellets. They dissolve very quickly, and it makes it easy to measure it out, and it's just convenient for me. I'll leave a link on where to buy some of these if you're interested. Now let's get into the ingredients. Now, comfrey is the main ingredient in this healing salve, and it is one of the plants that I grow a lot of in my garden, and I use it in my fruit tree guilds. Comfrey is a wonderful habitat for beneficial insects that you want to attract to your garden. It builds the soil with nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, potash, and calcium. It is a fantastic mulch, and it creates a rich compost and fertilizer. I not only add it to my compost pile, but I use it as a basic ingredient in my liquid fertilizer. The reason we're talking about today is because it is a medicinal herb. I prefer to use only dried herbs in my salves. So dried comfrey is also known as knit bone. Comfrey accelerates healing. It stimulates the growth of new cells. It's an anti-inflammatory. It's good for wounds, bruises, bones, and other injuries like that. The photo on the right is an herb dryer that Jonathan made for me. I air dry my herbs. I never put them into a dehydrator. And so they just go in here and I leave them there for, depending on the herb, for a week to a month. And then once that herb is nice and dry, then I put it into a mason jar and save it until I'm ready to use it. And salve is one of those things that I usually don't make during the summer or the fall just because I'm so busy doing different things. But the winter is a great time. Things have slowed down and I can take those dried herbs and I have the time to make that healing salve. I love lavender in my garden. It is beautiful. It has this calming fragrance. It repels many harmful insects,
But on the same note, when you look at your lavender plant, you can see that it attracts all kinds of pollinators and beneficial insects. So it's a really good thing to have in your garden. When it comes to the medicinal properties of lavender, it's packed. It's an antibacterial, antifungal, antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory. It has a real relaxing, soothing effect, and it helps with things like headaches, sprains, and skin irritation. Lemon balm is something every garden should have. It's really easy to grow. It's a perennial. The photo that you see right here is taken in February, and it's just starting to emerge. That's really close from the ground, and you can see I mulch really heavily with bark, and it's growing up through that bark. It has a delightful lemony scent, and it's great at attracting pollinators, but it also repels flies, ants, and mosquitoes. So it's a great companion plant in your garden. Now let's talk about lemon balm medicinally. It is a basic ingredient in almost everything I make, whether it's teas or salves or tinctures. This one is really important. It's an antibacterial, antioxidant, antimicrobial. It's antiviral, and it is fantastic when it comes to cold sores or herpes. And then it's very soothing. Now, mints in the garden, I actually use spearmint this time in my recipe. You can use different things, but for the most part, mints in the garden can be a great ground cover. They will take over if you let them, so be careful where you plant them. I've planted them out in the orchard where my chickens free range because they're great for the chickens, and it doesn't matter if they take over in the orchard because it's a great ground cover and the chickens actually love to eat it. Mints attract pollinators. They repel flies, aphids, moths, fleas, and ants. They have a delightful scent. It is so nice when I am working in the garden just to be able to smell the different varieties of mint that I have. They're delicious in your food and your teas and your drinks. And they have a lot of medicinal properties. And let's talk about that. The reason I put spearmint in my salve is because, again, it's packed antibacterial, antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory, antifungal, antioxidant, and antiviral. And it adds a nice scent because sometimes the salve, the way that I make it, can be a little bit earthy smelling. So we have to make sure that we add things that will help it be pleasant. Now, plantain in the garden, I don't know that there's a whole lot of benefits for my garden to have it. It reseeds readily, and so it just spreads like crazy. And there's two kinds of plantain. This is the narrow leaf. There's also the wide leaf. I have more of the narrow leaf than I do the wide leaf. So I'm not sure that it has a whole bunch of benefits for my garden, but it's such an important medicinal herb that I grow quite a bit of plantain in my garden. When I make my tinctures, I put the dried herb into a mason jar, and then I cover it with vodka, and I put the lid on it and label it and date it, and then I stick it in my cold storage room. You could probably strain a tincture after 6 weeks or so, but mine usually sits on the shelf for a year or so until I get my next batch of new herbs, and then I strain it. Plantain is an antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, antihistamine, interesting. It reduces skin inflammation and pain. It's also a purifier, and it draws out the infection. If you have a splinter and you put plantain on it, it will help to draw that splinter out. That's why plantain is an important ingredient in my salve, both because it helps with the pain and it helps to draw out that infection should you have any. You should never be using a salve on an open wound. We're talking about minor problems. We're talking about skin rashes and scrapes and things like that. Any open gaping wound, something that would require stitches or anything like that, I would not put a salve into that. Calendula is a wonderful companion plant. It repels insects such as aphids, white flies, and hopefully squash bugs. This is my grow tunnel that you can see in the background, and we have a real problem with squash bugs here. I grow winter squash and beans and things like that over this grow tunnel. And this year I planted a whole row of calendula in hopes to keep the squash bugs at bay. Although calendula is an annual, I will never have to replant it because it reseeds so readily that over and over again, I will just get calendula coming up all along that side. Calendula attracts beneficial insects such as bees, butterflies, ladybugs, hoverflies, and lacewings. In good, healthy soil, you have a fungi net that is very important to the health of your plants, and the roots of calendula are really beneficial to that. The bright yellow and orange flowers add a lot of beauty to the garden, and one of the big reasons why I grow it is because it is an edible medicinal herb. Now, for this salve. I use the calendula tincture. Sometimes I'll use different tinctures. It just depends kind of on my mood and what I have on hand. But calendula is antifungal, anti-inflammatory, antibacterial. It's good for wounds, burns, eczema, diaper rash, and it reduces scarring. Reducing the scarring is really important. I always like to use a little bit of tincture in my salve as a preservative. In this tincture, I have not only the benefit of the alcohol as a preservative, but it has all the benefits of calendula concentrated inside that liquid. One of the last ingredients is an essential oil. There are so many different essential oils out there that you might want to consider. And what's pictured here is just some of the ones that I have. Oregano is a really hot oil. If you are making a nice, cool, calming salve, you're not going to want to put oregano in it. My favorites and what I used in this one is peppermint oil and lemon oil. Lemon oil is really good at bleaching and kind of the scar reduction factor. So that's one of the reasons that I use it, besides the fact that I really enjoy that little lemony smell. And then peppermint oil. Peppermint oil has a lot of different properties that I really like in a salve, so I always include peppermint oil in my salves. So let's talk about how to make it. I combine all my dry herbs and my oil in a slow cooker, but I set the temperature to warm. Some slow cookers don't have a warm setting, but low is a little bit too high to be doing this. It might be a good idea to invest in a slow cooker that has a warm setting. I put the lid on and then I give it a few days to infuse well. The herbs should be nice and crispy, kind of like they've been deep fried when they're ready to go. And as a side note, I don't waste any of this. Once I've strained out all these herbs, I toss them either into the compost or just into our chicken orchard, and the chickens love them. The next step is to drain the oil. I like to let it set for a little while and try and drain. This isn't really good to squeeze it. I haven't found a lot of success with the crunchy herbs, but I do let it drain for quite a while so that I can capture as much of that oil as I possibly can. Notice what a beautiful, dark, rich infused oil you get after this process has been completed. Next, I clean out the slow cooker because I don't want any particles of the herbs that may be left in there to still be in there. So I clean it out really well. And then I return that infused oil to the slow cooker. At this point, I do set the slow cooker to low because I want the beeswax to be able to melt, and that takes a little bit of a higher heat. You could totally do this on the stove, but for me, the lazy mom, being able to just dump it in the slow cooker and leave it for a while is very effective. I also add the tincture at this point. The alcohol in the tincture is a really good preservative, but I don't want the alcohol to be too strong and burn or cause problems. But I really want that calendula to be strong in there. If I put the tincture in at the same time that I put the beeswax in, some of that alcohol will evaporate off. And then I do cover this with a lid, and I'll come in back and stir it a few times until the wax is completely melted. Once that wax is completely melted, I transfer it to my KitchenAid with the whip attachment, and I add the oils. I place the mixer on low and I just let it slowly mix while it cools. If I skip this step, then the salve seems a little bit harder, but this way it's softer. So I just keep mixing it until it's only slightly warm just before it's ready to set up. Then I immediately pour the salve into clean jars. In this case, I'm using used baby food jars because they were free. And free is a really good thing when you're working really hard to save money and build your stores. The salve will thicken as it cools. I don't like it when it's really hard. And sometimes I have made it where I just used too much wax. So I'm coming to a happy medium. I'm learning every time I make this, making it a little bit better. You can dip a spoon in the salve and put it in the freezer for a couple minutes. And that will give you an idea of what the finished product will be like. And at that point, you could add more wax if that's what you'd like to do. Every time I make salve, I include a label on every jar. Because I'm always doing it just a little bit different, and as I use this, I'll think, oh, I wish I would have added this to it, or maybe it had too much of this. And by always having a label on it, I know what's in there. The other factor is if someone has some type of a reaction, then I can narrow down what it is that they might have reacted to, and that's really important too. I never make a lot to store for a long time, so I don't know how long it will truly store for, because that's not my intent. My intent is always to have fresh herbs and fresh salve available. This salve is like gold, and it cost $20 for me to make 24 4-ounce jars of organic healing salve. A lot of that cost savings is because I grew a lot of the herbs in my yard, and quite frankly, they all grow like weeds. They're not hard to grow, and they're very beneficial for my overall garden. For me, taking the time to make the salve is totally worth it. Not only do I save money, but I get to create designer salves that are exactly what I need them to be. What herbs would you like in your designer salve? If I can do this, you can do this. Don't be afraid. Got some oil? Got some herbs? It's time to get started. I invite you to visit the Provident Prepper and see some of the other wonderful things that we are doing to become more self-reliant as a family. Also on YouTube, you can see our video, Elderberry Syrup Recipe, and that has come in very handy this winter with all the cold and flus around. And the video, Yummy Survival Bread, which shows you how to make delicious breads using natural yeast.
And now it's your turn to make your version of a homemade salve. You can grow your own herbs or buy them online, or you can skip that process altogether and just put essential oils in to create your salve. It's up to you. And now for the question of the day. What experience do you have making homemade salves, and what are your favorite ingredients? Comment below. And thanks for being part of the solution.